Master, give the blessing. Blessed is the kingdom of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, now and ever and unto ages of ages.
Amen. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for the salvation of our souls, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, the good estate of the holy churches of God, and for the union of all men, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house, and for those who enter with faith, reverence, and the fear of God, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our Father and Metropolitan Joseph, the venerable priesthood, the diaconate in Christ, for all the clergy and the people, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Metropolitan Paul, Archbishop John, for their quick release from captivity and safe return, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the President of the United States and all civil authorities, and for armed forces everywhere, especially Peter, Ronnie, Andrew, Joshua, Connor, Skyler, Benjamin, Thaddeus, and Adam, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
for this city, for every city and land, and for the faithful who dwell therein, for healthful seasons, for abundance of the fruits of the earth, and for peaceful times, let us pray to the Lord.
Have mercy.
For travelers by sea, by land, and by air, for the sick and the suffering, for captives and their salvation, and especially for those suffering for the faith, let us pray to the Lord. For our deliverance from all affliction, wrath, danger, and need, help us, save us, have mercy on us, and keep us, O God, by thy grace. Calling to remembrance our all-holy, immaculate, most blessed and glorious Lady Theotokos and ever-Virgin Mary, with all the saints, let us commend ourselves and each other and our whole life unto Christ our God.
For unto thee are due all glory, honor, and worship, to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and ever, and unto ages of ages.
Our all-holy, immaculate, most blessed, and glorious Lady Mary.
King, he is clothed with majesty. The Lord is clothed with strength, and he hath girded himself.
O Son of God,
thank you.
wisdom, let us attend.
Thank you.
From here on, his voice has gone up to all the earth. The heavens declare the glory of God.
Wisdom.
The reading is from St. Paul's second letter to the Corinthians.
Let us attend.
Remember this. Whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to bless you abundantly, so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. As it is written, they have freely scattered their gifts to the poor. Their righteousness endures forever. Now he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will also supply and increase your store of seed and will enlarge the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way so that you can be generous on every occasion. And through us, your generosity will result in thanksgiving to God.
Each be to thee that readeth.
But instead, I would like to talk about
the theology of giving. You know, why do we talk so much about money? Is it just we're mercenary and we want to drive around in Cadillacs and things like that? As you know, I've got several myself. But no, there's really a very important spiritual reason for giving, which St. Paul alluded to in this lesson this morning. It's important that we give. It's a reflection of our theology, our view of God. You know, it's how you see God affects your giving, and really how you give leads your theology, leads your view of God. It's important. Now, I know there's folks that might think, what in the world is giving to the church or not have to do with theology? Isn't that more like a personal choice? And I would say that's an ill-formed thought, because theology is life and is a part of everything. There is nothing in life that is not connected to theology, because God is everywhere present and fills us all things. Everything. I mean, even what we might think of as the baser things in life, you know, they reflect some kind of theology in a way. So there's no aspect of life that is secular or theology-free. Nevertheless, I think there are many people who are either misinformed or ignorant of Orthodox Christian theology and assume that giving really is more of a utilitarian thing. It comes down to needs. Mine versus the church, the community, the parish, whatever. It's a very utilitarian view, and I suspect rather self-serving to decide that if the parish seems to be doing okay financially, then it doesn't really need my money. And that's a very practical way of looking at it. But I don't think we understand what we're saying, what that says about our view of God. We might assume also that we all have the same theology, the same views of God, but not necessarily true. Your personal view of God, how you see God, touching your life, is reflected in your giving habits, whether you realize it or not. And I hope this is what I can help us understand today. Returning to our epistle lesson, the first thing to point out, I think, is that this passage is not about tithing or regular giving to support the parish or the temple, that sort of thing. That's not what this passage is about at all. Paul was addressing the church in Corinth because there was a need in one of their sister parishes in Macedonia. And the Corinthians had previously promised to help out. So Paul was writing to them ahead of time. He's going to come to Corinth with some of the Macedonian brethren. And he doesn't want to be embarrassed, basically. He wants to make sure that the money is there when he shows up. And the reason why I say this has nothing to do with tithing, but was in fact about a special offering, a special gift, is because sometimes folks try to apply St. Paul's words, where he says, each one must do as he has made up his mind. And they try to apply that to giving to their parish. You know, so like standing on the full authority of St. Paul, I have made up my mind to give nothing to my parish. Tell you what, that's bad theology. That's not what we're talking about here. Clearly, if you read the scriptures well, Christianity is all about giving. Jesus talks about giving an awful lot, and so do the apostles. And our holy tradition is all about that. We give to the parish, we are instructed, and as we are able, we give beyond that to meet the needs of others. We give of our money, but also of our time, our energy, our life. And why all this giving? Why this emphasis on giving, giving, giving? Because it is a reflection of God, who is the ultimate giver. We give because God first gave. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. God made the ultimate sacrificial gift for us. And no amount of human giving can ever match what God has given and continues to give for us. But here's the rub. This is where I talk about your personal theology coming into play, because not everybody sees it that way. I think if you were to ask people to write down or express their views of God, this wouldn't come out of them. But in a practical way, in their secret thoughts, in the way they live, maybe it shows that some do not believe that God is a giver, that God is the most generous example of giving. No matter the abundance of great mercies that God has bestowed upon some folks, the rich and fulfilling life that He has called them to, or even the immeasurable joy that potentially awaits them, many people are disappointed in God because of what they do not have. They focus on the have-nots. You know my rule 80-20? They focus on the 20, not the 80. For them, God appears to be a miser, or something perhaps far worse, perhaps cruel. Many people are angry or hurt by the thought that God has denied them what? Basically the good things that other people have. They see what other people enjoy, and maybe they don't have that in one degree or another. And so eventually it comes down to why me, God? Why don't I have what other people have? Why can't I have what other people have? I only want what's fair. Let me ask you, what do you think the giving habits would be of those who think that God is a miser, who feel like they've been shortchanged, that they haven't been blessed? Are they going to turn around and give abundantly? Perhaps not. Their giving is directly affected by their theology, by their view of God. So I'm not saying that everyone who's had these thoughts or felt denied or been disappointed is, angry with God. But we all know that the temptation is there. Sometimes we have false views, to be upset, to be frustrated, to be hurt. And these kinds of understandings need to be fought by doing what is right, by living right, by obedience to God. Even so, the green-eyed monster of envy doesn't just bite the so-called have-nots. Even those who still have much may not also see the hand of God in the midst of their blessings. I actually talked with a man one time, a Christian man. I have to put the little air quotes on there. Because, he told me once, he says, "What's all this nonsense about God giving us what we have?" He says, "I'm smart. I went to school. I joined this company. I advanced. I attained to the level that I'm at. I made all my money. God didn't give me anything. It's all myself. It's me." And so what do you imagine his conclusion was? What was he going to give to the parish? You get a big zero. Smoke rings. He gave nothing. He wasn't going to give God a penny because God hadn't earned it. He earned it. Well, that's kind of extreme, but bad theology certainly affects our giving. Whether we think that God has withheld from us, and so we withhold from Him, or whatever the case may be, we need to do what's right. We need, if our theology isn't right, we need to live right to make our theology right. Because it's all connected. It's all connected. The person who gives sparingly leads a life that does not reflect the sacrificial generosity of God. It's got nothing to do with how he feels or what he thinks or his justification. He is not an icon of God the giver. He's an icon of a miser. He's an image of a false God. A God that takes but does not give. Who looks out for himself but not for others. That's not an icon that we want to be. It's not the one we're called to be. If we sow bountifully, we shall also reap bountifully. Well, this is not the proof text for prosperity gospel preachers, I'm sure you know. But something of far greater and more eternal worth. If we sow bountifully, if we give generously, even sacrificially, it is a living out of a good, well-formed Christian theology. Give because God gives. It shows that we believe that God is good and the giver of all things, and that everything we have is from his hand. That if we give, we're not going to run out. Gee, God, I gave to the poor and then I starved to death myself. Even in the scripture today, Paul promises God will give abundantly. It shows that we trust God when we give. It shows that we believe the God who says, I know your needs and I will supply you unfailingly. It shows gratitude and practical thanksgiving. You say you love God, that you give thanks to God. You know, this is a very real way that we show it. Because let's face it, it's so important to us. We want to give our best to God. It shows that we love others more than ourselves alone, and we'll join them in supporting the common good. It shows that we understand community and the importance of maintaining a strong and vibrant parish and respecting others who also give. I was frankly embarrassed when they put up the giving amounts, you know, at the business meeting last month. Fortunately, there were no names, just amounts. But we saw that on the left side, there was some very generous annual giving. And on the right, three or four columns, there were smoke rings for people who give nothing. I was embarrassed. I was embarrassed, you know, for the folks who don't give. I mean, you know, even the widow's mite, you know, it would be something. It shouldn't be zero. I was embarrassed for myself because somehow I had failed you to teach you the importance of giving. No, I don't have a Cadillac. I don't play golf. I don't live in a house. You know, I have an apartment. You know, where it's not about, you know, we're not building a cathedral. It's, you know, we are meeting our needs. Of course, you know, a house of worship in Orange County is cha-ching, right? But we're also giving a lot. We're doing a lot of good things with the money you entrust to us. We're giving to a lot of missions work. We're giving to, there's a lot of programs that we have. And we're paying off our mortgage responsibly. But theologically speaking, if I have not taught you or encouraged you to give because it is right, you know, then I failed. And I apologize, and I hope you do better. That doesn't mean I'm going to talk about giving all the time. I'll give you a break. But when we increase our giving, it shows that we are growing and coming into a true knowledge of the living God, a true understanding of the God who is the giver of life and all good things. We're no longer worshiping the false idols of things and stuff, you know, and so forth. And it shows that we truly desire that our single greatest motivation in life be love. Never again fear or envy or doubt or anxiety, things that also surround money. But we use our money for love, to grow in love. Every good blessing is bestowed upon those who give bountifully. Nothing good ever bestows the miserly, except maybe three dreams at night. Like Scrooge. But let us get our theology straight and honor our God with our generous gifts of thanksgiving and worship to the glory of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Help us, save us, have mercy on us, and keep us, O God, for thy grace, wisdom.
Let pardon always by thy life we ascribe glory unto thee, to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and ever, and unto ages of ages. sake return. Thou, O God, remember them his kingdom. Always now and ever and up to ages of ages. States and all civil authorities and our armed forces everywhere. The Lord God, remember them in his kingdom, always, now, and ever, and unto ages of ages.
Amen.
For the Orthodox service of God, especially for the Archpriest Wayne and Trierlin, for Kevin and for his family, for Evangeline, Arnold, Elizabeth, Cassia, Gabriella, Peter, Michelle, Autumn, Aubrey, Lauren, Maggie, Claire, Christina, Mary, Stacy, that they have mercy, life, peace, health, salvation, visitation, pardon and remission of their sins. The Lord God remember them in his kingdom, always, now, and ever, and unto ages of ages. For the Orthodox servants of God departed this life, especially for Bishop Antu and for Danny on the 40th anniversary of his repose, the Lord God remember them in his kingdom, always, now, and ever, and unto ages of ages.
Ourselves and each other and our whole life unto Christ.
Christ our God. We give thanks unto thee also for this ministry, which now and
beside thee thousands of archangels, and then thousands of angels, the cherubim and the seraphim, six-winged, many-eyed, soaring aloft, borne on their pinions, singing the triumphal hymn, shall be proclaiming and saying,
Thank you.
Michael, O Lord of our Father and Metropolitan Joseph, do thou grant unto thy holy churches in peace, safety, honor, health, and length of days, and rightly dividing the word of thy truth. Of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ be with you all. Sit on high, and are here invisibly present with us, and mouse.
those who may be visiting with us, if this is your first time to an Orthodox church, welcome. Glad you chose St. Barnabas. We're about to serve communion, and I have to remind you that communion can only be served through people who are chrismated members of the Orthodox Church. You can ask about that later if you're interested. We do have some blessed bread, which is not a sacrament, and we will be serving at the end of the service, and you're welcome to join us in partaking of that. And for Orthodox Christians, please remember that we need to be in good communion ourselves, and having made at least a recent confession, that we not take communion carelessly.
With the fear of God, with faith and love, draw near.
Blessed is he that comes in the name of the Lord. God is the Lord, and has revealed himself to us.
Precious and all holy body, blood of our Lord Jesus Christ,
Let us pray.
sanctifies those who put their trust in thee. Save thy people and bless thine inheritance. Preserve the fullness of thy church. Sanctify those who love the beauty of thine house. Glorify them and recompense by thy divine power. And forsake us not, O hope on thee. Give peace to thy world, to thy churches, to the priests, to all civil authorities, to our armed forces, and to all thy people. For every good and perfect gift is from above and cometh down from thee, the Father of lights. And unto thee we ascribe glory, thanksgiving, and worship, to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and ever, and unto ages of ages.
Remember everlasting,
and that all holy, good, and life-giving Spirit, now and ever and unto ages of ages. Memorable Master, who art worthy of blessedness and eternal memory. Christ our God, have mercy on us and save us.